Martin Jiggs at the Transcendence Exhibition, and we're just going to have a little bit of an extra delve into this painting and see what else we can find. So,
what can I ask you?
Well, I struggle initially to think what else I could give from our previous encounter with the painting, which may or may not be used in the edit.
So, when you finish them, do you ever think they're pretty?
This is a very slippery question. Because the whole point of making the paintings that I've been making recently is to have something, a system in place that would necessarily obviate that.
Yeah. Stop there being a chance of prettiness.
No, to stop my choice in
stop your choice
designing a pretty object.
Okay. Yeah.
Because I don't see myself as a designer. I'm not an interior designer. I'm not one of those people that design the sides of Ocado vans. A trainer designer.
Yeah.
Although actually those kinds of things are of interest to me, because they're things that we see out.
Well, we see it all around, don't we?
Colour is a difficult thing, actually, in terms of creating a system for it. I've had various sort of systems or devices that I would employ to limit those decisions, or to give me those decisions based on either a dice roll or...
Yeah, have you done that?
Yeah, or I've had lexicons of how I would be feeling on a particular day, which would create a colour, which I would then use if I was in the studio then. So these kinds of...
I've tried to do pictures where I've randomised what the colour choices will be.
Yeah.
I wasn't actually thinking of doing it to do prettier. I was just, it's like you say, once you take yourself away from those decision-making processes.
Don't get me wrong, I don't think it's a way, I don't think it's to de-pretty it. I think it's some sort of, just that removal of myself, almost as a way of sort of analysing my own predisposition for particular things, because I suppose I am predisposed to liking reticulated patterns and quasi sort of systematic designs within architecture or tiling patterns and all these kinds of things. So these things that have actually fed the work are then subsumed by the very process that created them, if that makes sense. So it's they're quite sort of perverse.
So how did you choose the colours for this one?
They progressed from blues, basically.
Really?
Yeah.
So the blue was the first colour?
The blue, actually there are several colours underneath.
So yeah, there's quite a few, there's like dark blues.
There were greys, dark green, it became sort of green, and it became beige, and then it became blue. and I think that, like I was saying with the sort of lexicons of feelings, manifesting a colour, I think those things just happen in a very intuitive way, which I'm uncomfortable with, because I think I'm just ultimately controlling when it comes to my artwork, and I would really like to understand, but actually there is always this other thing that happens that is uncontrolling, or that you don't know where it necessarily comes from. Where does that come from? Why would you, prioritise one colour over another? Yeah. Where does that come from?
So in a way, by giving yourself all those rules, you're almost trying to let yourself see that moment of magic more clearly.
I think that's a really nice way to put it, but I think that is what's happening.
That's what's happening.
Yeah. So the blue gave way to the orange, which then fed back into the blue again, because these are sort of the locus points, the sort of beginning dots that touched particular points of the previous process underneath.
Okay.
And then the colour becomes more red, and then the red turns into blue as we go in here, and then into white. So it's a reaction from that colour. So it's a push and pull, and sort of an amplification of a particular process.
Yeah, it's interesting. I should just think these are really beautiful. These bluey grey colours here that almost disappear.
Yeah,
I can't help it. I just think they're pretty. Well, not pretty. They're beautiful. The colours working on at least a variety of levels
underneath. Isn't it?
Yeah. So and the tonality within the colour.
Yeah.
Is taking it back into that place.
Yeah. This is it. whether that it certainly wasn't luck, but it was trying to, you know, once again reflect back into the. Because yeah. When I was painting these square structures, I was aware that I would be losing what was underneath.
Yeah.
So this is almost sort of a nod back to the.
Process,
as is the, you know, the constructed cutout part.
Because I wonder, constructed cutout, because you could almost read the constructed cutout as a purposeful attack on what could be pretty.
Yeah, I mean, I'm quite uncomfortable with the shape of it. It's not a particularly pleasant. Yeah. It's almost like a, I don't know, like some kind of cartoon crash.
Yeah, like
Sarah mentioned earlier, that it could be some sort of, you know, a crack in the wall or something.
There is
something, sort of quite ugly about that in a way. Or certainly, not necessarily ugly, but sort of quite uncomfortable in relation to, you know, the sort of the regularity of other things that have happened. But like I said before, it's, I suppose, a device to allow the viewer to contemplate potentially where what they're seeing has come from.
Yeah. Oh, that's really cool. So, I was just curious, because in these ones, you kind of allowed the squares to organically explode with each other.
Mm.
Is that how you'd say?
Have you
done ones before where they're more regimented?
Yes.
Yeah, you have?
Yes, I've kind of gone from that. Well, I'm sort of left wanting with those paintings. I've actually had a really interesting conversation, albeit briefly, with Ruth Solomons, whose work we saw earlier, next to the Louisa Chambers, the kind of constructive things. I was talking about this concept of overpainting.
Yeah.
So I think that people in my studio sort of say, oh, it's finished, it's sort of there.
Yeah.
Actually, I haven't discovered the thing that I'm trying to get.
Okay.
Some sort of these systems or these ways of working are just ways for me to think about something other than that's yet to strike me.
To strike you. I was only curious because it's a weird illusion, but when the Velvet Underground and Andy Warhol, they did all those experiences and they had loads of strobe lights in them, and the guy who did the strobes just sat in a room with the strobes on for days on end, and he experimented with them where they'd randomly change, so they weren't exact, you know, sometimes it'd be fast, sometimes it'd be slow, and that didn't mess him up very much. But then what he really experimented with was keeping the repetitive thing. And that really took him into another world.
I'm thinking Chinese water torture.
Yeah, no, exactly. Because that's what I was just thinking. In a way, when you were doing the more hardcore sort of controlled repetition, was that almost taking you more to a weird zone?
It's interesting. That's quite a complex, loaded question
in terms of
my methodology, just because actually, you know, once and at the same time I felt uncomfortable and also relieved at this process of disabling purposefully breaking a system and stretching a system and amplifying a system. But I'm uncomfortable in a way with its handmade nature and with what the final thing looks like.
Oh, fantastic.
Because it's like I say, it's not a design, so it's not something I've gone, because you in theory have a systemized piece of artwork that then would give you something very ordered and beautiful and regular, whether or not that would be more insanity provoking than Chinese water torture I think ultimately it's given me a certain release
and so you're going to make
and potential. Yes, I think so.
Yeah.
I'm currently making more, but they do look very different.
Do this one?
Yes. Which, I suppose, I'm just thinking about all the other things we've spoken about today, and in terms of having a practice, you often see so many artists that have this very sort of, and certainly when you see it in retrospect, this beautiful sort of linearity of work that is very much.
Yeah.
Feels like a solid progression, whereas I feel like my work probably has had that in the past, but at the moment it's kind of leaping from and hopping over all these different areas. So I'm trying to absorb that, and actually showing this painting here is facilitating that process, because it's, like I said before, it's the paintings do often feel dead once they're finished, yeah, once they're, yeah, put them into the spaces.
Nice. No changes. Well, brilliant. Changes. Oh, thanks. I've loved chatting about it. It's really cool. I'd love to see some information and how they progress.
It'd be a pleasure.
Awesome. Cheers. Bumbuckler.